broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon to all of our young scholars throughout the state of California. This is DHTV, Critical Reasoning Philosophy 120, and I'm Dr. Robert Cubijos coming to you from the California State University Dominguez Hills campus. Hope everybody's having a great middle of the week. We are still in Chapter 2, dealing with meanings and definitions, very important concepts, especially when we are required to speak, when we're required to write that research paper, write a thesis, or even to write a dissertation if you go on in your graduate studies and earn a PhD or some other doctorate, your terminal degree. So very important, and we will try and finish up Chapter 2 today. We've got several videos that hopefully hit home the point for you, some sample problems that we'll do. And then before we jump into Chapter 4, we might even get into our first critical reasoning response. That is critical reasoning response number one. As you recall from our discussions regarding the syllabus, there are three of those critical reasoning responses. I'd like to give you an example either today if we can get to it, if not definitely during our next broadcast next Wednesday, to walk you through what's required to accomplish that critical reasoning response. More on that to follow. You've got our 800 number at the bottom of your screen, and also the other contact point, our email address. There will be a question of the day that we will get to shortly, and we will, as usual, take the first five email responses and read those. Others will be tabulated, and I will look at those later to award you the participation points. Of course, if you want to call in with your response, we encourage you to do that, and we love listening to you and taking your calls live on the air. There have been a few other items posted to Blackboard. Let me review those before we jump into today's lecture. We're in lecture 2.3 if you want to grab your textbook and open to that page. But if you would turn your attention to the Blackboard, and let me just scroll down here on announcements. I did put up the homework assignments, as you can see whenever we get to the, there they are, the homework assignments for Chapter 2. And as always, these additional problems that I assign are not to be turned in. They're simply to help you do a self-test on your own understanding. You see I've got the sections that we're reading, sections 2.1 through 2.5, and then problems in various Roman numeral sections at the end of each section, and then problems to do. And as I'd mentioned before, the answers are available on Blackboard. And let's see, we've also posted a test. Just to remind you, this coming Sunday, midnight, September 27th, our first quiz is due. And so if you have not already taken that, or if you've not started preparing for that, I would encourage you to do that as well. Keep an eye on Blackboard and our announcements. I'm trying very hard to always attach an email send command so that anything that goes on the announcement page goes into your inbox. So check your emails regularly too. That's again your Toro email. So why don't we go back to where we left off. That is section 2.3, talking about definitions. We want to make sure that we're using definitional techniques properly. Definition, just to define our term as the textbook does, is a form of phraseology that assigns a meaning to a word or to a group of words. Every definition consists of two parts, and here's where our book loves to use Latin again. The definiendum is the word, or excuse me, the definiendum and the definiens. The definiendum is the word that's being defined. The definiens are the words that do the defining. So in a dictionary, there is the definiendum, the particular word you look up, and the definiens are the words that are used to define that word. Probably want to pay close attention to that, make sure you've got that straight. That might be a pretty good quiz question. We don't like throwing a lot of foreign language around, but the book makes a good point of that, so we might throw that in. In 2013, when I was a visiting scholar at the University of Cambridge, I was taken aback by the competition of the two Manchester soccer teams there in England, the Reds and the Blues. And there's these ESPN commercials that are talking about these various terms. They even put together a commercial that talks about some of the terms that the Reds and the Blues are using. And I thought, oh, gosh, that's a great video to give an example of definitions, watching these two guys kind of attacking one another, saying, if I was a Red or if I was a Blue, and they're from the opposite sides of Manchester. Great video. So why don't we talk about definitions and let this video, this ESPN commercial from the UK, tell a little bit of a definitional story for us about these two opposing teams. Watch this.
If I'd have been born a Blue, I'd have been a proper fake.
If I'd have been born a Red, I'd be a right muppet.
A miserable git.
I've been born a right divver.
Real divver.
That's some real scummy mum and dad.
Proper mingers they'd be.
What? Wow. I've been born a Billy No Mates.
My life would be a tragedy.
I'd probably have some crap job.
Chips are up! I wouldn't have such a fit burn now, would I?
My name's Becky.
I'd have no life, no friends, no future.
He'd be at home, sitting on his tod.
If I'd been born over there, I'd have been born a right bunk off.
Can't even imagine it.
Can't even imagine it.
Good job I was born here.
A lot of those words we don't use here in the United States, but common in some of the pubs there in Cambridge. And thankfully, after taking a course like this, you wouldn't be a right plonker, an unintelligent person, right? And while I'm here sitting on my tod, let me go on ahead and proceed. Let's talk a little bit about some definitional techniques here. We talked about the word definition. Let me give you a word, and it's the word theist, and let's go on ahead and define this. This is the word that we would find in a dictionary. The word theist means a person who believes that there is a God. The definiendum is the word, or the group of words that's supposed to be defined. In this case, it's the word theist. That's the definiendum. The definiens is the word or group of words that does the defining. A person who believes in God, or that there is a God. The definitions serve various purposes for us. It was Plato that said that these definitions and these understandings of words help us understand some of the eternal essences, whether it is justice or piety or some of the virtues. And Plato is one of the first to identify some of the importance of understanding words and how they're used. They help us get our arms around some of these eternal essences. Well, let's talk about some of the different types of definitions, types of definitional techniques. Well, first there is a stipulative definition. A stipulative definition is a definition that assigns a meaning to a word for the first time. You wouldn't find it in a dictionary. It's something that's made up, like the word choodle. Choodle. Choodle means a cross between a chihuahua and a poodle. These are not either true or false. They're simply propositions or statements that we make to define a word that we've happened to make up. It's very common in families to have these made-up words. Let's talk about a lexical definition. What is a lexical definition? Well, the word lexical comes from lexicon, which is the old word for a dictionary. So a lexical definition is simply the definition of a word that we would find in a dictionary. It's the meaning that the word actually has in a language. For example, I use the word theist. The lexical definition of a theist is a person who believes in God. So lexical definition is the same as a dictionary definition. You know, a dictionary is a very interesting tool in our language, and just about every language has a dictionary. Of course, there are some groups of people that are off to themselves, rather isolated, and people go to learn that language and write a dictionary for them and write a grammar. But most languages do have a dictionary. The English dictionary has a very unique history, and we've got a video that will educate you about the history of the dictionary. Let's take a look at this, the age of the dictionary. Watch this.
The History of English in 10 Minutes. Chapter 7, The Age of the Dictionary, or the Definition of a Hopeless Task. With English expanding in all directions, along came a new breed of men called lexicographers who wanted to put an end to this anarchy, a word they defined as what happens when people spell words slightly differently from each other. One of the greatest was Dr. Johnson, whose Dictionary of the English Language took him 9 years to write. It was 18 inches tall and contained 42,773 entries, meaning that even if you couldn't read, it was still pretty useful if you wanted to reach a high shelf. For the first time, when people were calling you a pickle herring, a jobbernowl, or a fop doodle, you could understand exactly what they meant, and you'd have the consolation of knowing they were all using the standard spelling. Try as he might to stop them, words kept being invented, and in 1857 a new book was started that would become the Oxford English Dictionary. It took another 70 years to be finished after the first editor resigned to be an archbishop. The second died of TB, and the third was so boring that half his volunteers quit, and one of them ended up in an asylum. It eventually appeared in 1928, and has continued to be revised ever since, proving the whole idea you can stop people making up words is complete snuffbumble.
Well, if anything, dictionaries help us not only understand the common use of the language, but it also standardizes the spelling. A very big problem we find in a lot of ancient manuscripts that some of the words were spelled a lot differently. So very important. But for our purposes, the definition helps us eliminate ambiguity. You remember the term ambiguity? We talked about ambiguity and vagueness. Citing a lexical definition will really pinpoint the word and avoid any kind of ambiguity or vagueness. Let me give you an example of the word paper. Paper means, and if we look that up in a lexicon or in a dictionary, it would say, one, a sheet of material intended to receive writing is one example of a paper. Secondly, we would find a newspaper. The third possible definition of paper would be a literary composition. A fourth might be something like wallpaper. So there are some words that have a variety of definitions. Looking them up in a dictionary and defining exactly which term we want to use or terms we want to use will help us avoid ambiguity. The next type of definition that's talked about in our textbook is a precising definition. A precising definition. This is the third type, and it serves the purpose of getting specifically at the point or identifying a context in which the word is being used. To reduce vagueness of a word, especially if there's a continuum of definitions, a precising definition would serve us very well. The example that I'll give is the word adequate. So adequate means, in relationship to performance in our Philosophy 120 course, receiving a grade of at least a C. Notice that I identified a context in relation to our course. So you see I'm giving a context to which I'm giving a definition and a precising, I'm precisely giving its meaning. Question of the day now might be a good place to go ahead and insert that now that we're done with precising definition. And you can either call in or you can text in an example of an unusual made-up word that was used maybe in your family, and give us a definition. Give us the definition of that made-up word. I'll give you one in my family. When I would get home a little earlier than my two younger brothers, they'd come in about half an hour after me at 3 p.m, and they would say the word Jeet, J-E-E-T, Jeet. And they would just barrel in the front door and say, Jeet? Well, it means, have you eaten anything yet? Jeet, have you eaten anything yet? So it's a very distilled down word taken from all these syllables to ask me simply, have you eaten yet? So give me an example of a made up word that doesn't appear in a dictionary, that's a family word, and then let me know what its definition is. And that's our first question of the day. We've got a couple of sample problems that you might want to try a hand on. And the first one is slide number 55, asking the question about a scale. Scale means, one, a device for weighing, two, fish skin, or three, a series of musical notes. Try and see if you can classify which one this is. Would you say it's a lexical definition? Would you say that the sample that I've given you is a precising definition? Or do you think it might be a stipulative definition? Take a moment and look. Make your decision. Let's go to the next slide and see what the answer is. Well, it is a lexical definition. What you see in the first top half of the screen is what you would see in a dictionary. That's a lexical definition of the word scale. Let's take a look at our next slide, which gives a word senior. The word senior. And the example reads, senior means, when buying a ticket, that a purchaser must be at least 65 years old. Go ahead and classify that and see if you can determine what that is. Notice the context, when buying a ticket. So it's not a lexical definition. That's right, it's a precising definition. It's nailed down the occasion when this definition applies. When buying a ticket, senior means somebody that's at least 65 years old. Of course, in some other context, senior would mean something else. I see that we've got a caller calling in. And let's see if we can pick up what they want to respond about. Let's see if we can find out who it is that's calling. Hello?
Hi.
Hi. Caller, identify yourself, please.
I'm Bailey, and I'm calling from Upland.
Bailey, how are you today?
I am good. How are you?
I'm doing really good, too. Thanks so much for calling in, Bailey. Give us your response to the first question of the day.
Well, one thing that I made up recently was the word saddle sport, and it means either a spoil sport and a tattletale.
That's pretty good. I like that, Bailey. Thank you so much for calling in. Have a great day.
You too.
Thanks. Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah, and of course, the more humorous, the more we like to hear them, but we'll take anything we can get. Bailey, thank you so much. That was great. The next type of definition is a theoretical definition. A theoretical definition. Let's let you understand what that is. A theoretical definition is to give a theoretical characterization to the entities that the term denotes. Example for might be gold. Gold means an element having an atomic weight, an atomic number of 79 and an atomic weight of 197. Actually, I think the folks there in the control room know it better than I do. They've got it 196.97. Thank you, folks. Sharp people there in the control room. So this definition identifies gold in terms of its atomic theory of the elements. Imagine for a second, young scholars, that the type of paper that you're writing for a particular class might be more prone to a scientific bent, so you would use theoretical definitions of the things that you're talking about. You might even want to do this at the front of your paper, maybe in the opening paragraphs, carefully define your terms. You wouldn't necessarily use lexical definitions. You would probably use theoretical definitions obtained from your textbook that would be dealing with that scientific issues that you're dealing with. It's very important to make sure that your reader or your listeners know exactly what you're talking about. And the best thing to do is making sure that you're avoiding any ambiguity or any vagueness by using these types of definitional techniques. We've got a text that came in from Hosanna. Hosanna, thank you so much. Mawage is the word. rooted out of my family's love for the Princess Bride. I love it. Refers to a commitment made between two individuals, otherwise known as marriage. Mawage. I love that. Yes, and I remember the scene from the high bishop and just with his type of speech and all that. Mawage. That's very good. I like that. Our next example is a persuasive definition. Persuasive definition. This is given to engender a favorable attitude or an unfavorable attitude toward the things that the term denotes. So you're giving you're given a set of words to define something, and the thing that you're trying to define, you're doing that in very favorable or unfavorable words, depending upon the disposition you want your recipient reader or listener to have. The example that we give is communist. Communist means a person who values every human being as an individual and accords universal equality and basic rights to every human. As you can imagine, this is trying to engender a very favorable disposition towards communism. There could be another type of definition that somebody who is very adverse to communist form of government or communism in general that might have a different type of definition. But either way, whether you're trying to engender a favorable or an unfavorable attitude in your reader or your hearer, that is to give them a persuasive type definition. So that definition engenders an unfavorable type of disposition toward communism. We see that Lindsay has also sent us a text. Lindsay, thank you so much. Silly you, I hope I'm pronouncing it right, S-I-L-L-I-Y-U-E, is a word I made up when I say goodbye to my sister. It mainly means see you later, and it came about because we were being silly. Oh, that's good. Silly you. Sounds like maybe even a little bit British in there. Lindsay, thank you so much. That's very good. Well, folks, we've got a few more sample problems for you to try your hand at. This one that comes up next is defining the word earth. Defining the word earth. Earth means an oblate spheroid at the center of our solar system. Try and classify that. Which one do you think it is? Lexical, theoretical, or persuasive? You folks are probably coming up with theoretical, right? We're dealing with astronomy and sciences, so if you chose the second one, theoretical, you would get the point on the quiz. Very good. The next one is a cyber date. A cyber date, and that is defined as cyber date means a date arranged over the internet. Classify that. Which one do you think it is? If this was a multiple choice question on your quiz, would you select lexical definition, a stipulative definition, or a precising definition? If you selected the second one, stipulative definition, you would be right and you would get the point. Let's give you another one. Drunk means, when driving a vehicle in California, having a blood alcohol ratio of greater than or equal to 0.08. Classify this. Probably not lexical, probably not persuasive, but we see that there's a context that offset by commas when driving a vehicle in California. So if you chose precising definition, you would have gotten the point because that is the answer. That is to give the term drunk a precising definition. Well, we want to go to our next video in just a moment. It demonstrates that even if the definiendum, the word that's being defined, sounds strange, and the definiends, the words doing the defining, should still give us some kind of cognitive understanding of what the word is, what the word means, at least somewhere in the world. So we may not understand the definiendum, maybe it's some very awkward world, but the definiends, the words that are doing the defining, your words, if you're defining a term, should be very intelligible. So let's watch 12 nouns with absurdly specific definitions. Watch this.
Ball tag. Ageless. Hippo Heptaclitis. Quiddler. Barn.
We got cheap wood for you.
Xylopolis.
Cheap wood. Cheap wood.
Pre-antepenultimate. Ultra crepidarianism.
Some interesting words, right? With some astoundingly specific definitions, the words that do the defining. Well, folks, we've finished up section 2.3. We want to skip over section 2.4 and go into 2.5, but we'll circle back after 2.5 into 2.4. And there are some homework problems that I would suggest you do on page 100 of the 11th edition of your book. That's section Roman numeral 1 after 2.3, problems 2, 4, 6, and 8. And time permitting, I might randomly select some homework problems to go through and give you the answers, especially some of those that may be a little more complex. Well, let's push, as I said, into section 2.5. This has to do with criteria for lexical definitions. Criteria for lexical definitions. As you're turning forward, it looks like we've got somebody on the phone, and I see we just got another text. Let's go on ahead and see if we can chat with our caller. Hello, caller, are you there?
Hi.
Hi, Shannon from Redlands. How are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good, too. Thanks. What's your response to the question of the day?
Okay, so my response is, it's not actually my word, it's my best friend's word.
Okay.
But the word is fabulicious, which basically just means fabulous and awesome and amazing.
Uh-huh. You know, and I think I might use that for maybe a dinner that is just delicious. I could say to the waiter, this is fabulicious, right?
Yes.
Shannon, thanks so much. You have a great day.
You too.
Thanks. And this is from Asher. Asher's writing in. He says, a made-up word in my family is loungeabout. Loungeabout. And that's hyphenated. We use it when someone forgets to do their chores. Because of this, I hear this word a lot. Asher, that's pretty good. Folks, thanks so much for calling in and for texting in. I appreciate those. Well, there are several rules in Section 2.5 that we want to pay particular attention to, especially when we're the one that's doing the defining in a paper or in a speech or in a debate. I want to make sure that we do not break any of these 8 rules. The first rule, and some of these go very quickly and some of them are very commonsensical, is a lexical definition should conform to the standards of proper grammar. This is rule number 1. A lexical definition should conform to the standards of proper grammar. For example, insanity means if you have an unsound or deranged mind. What I just read to you is grammatically incorrect. Insanity means if you have an unsound or deranged mind. To correct that, I should have said, if I was defining the word insanity means the condition of having an unsound or a deranged mind. It's not if you have, it's the condition of having. Lexical definitions, rule number 2. A lexical definition should convey the essential meaning of the word that's being defined. The example that we will give is the word snow. If I was to say snow means white stuff, I'm breaking rule number 2. Because I've not conveyed the essential meaning or the essential understanding that snow is made of water. There's no mention of water there. To correct what I'm saying, I should say something like this. Snow means small, white crystals of frozen water formed from water vapor in the air, or something along those lines. Then I would not be breaking rule 2. I have to convey the essential meaning of the word that's being defined. Lexical definition rule number 3. A lexical definition should be neither too broad or too narrow. Let's see, this is going to be broad and not too narrow, right? I can't do it the other way. I can't say broad and narrow. I better get that straight. So the word clarinet, let's define that. If I was to say clarinet means a wind instrument, I have broken rule number 3. The definition is too broad because the Delphinians wind instrument includes horns and trumpets and saxes, and it includes too much. So I should say instead clarinet means a single reed woodwind instrument. And I would not have been too broad or too narrow at that point. Another example would be the word drill. Drill means a tool for making holes. Well, the definition is too narrow because drills are also used to make holes in metal and plastic and concrete. It's too narrow. The definitions includes too little. To correct what I'm saying, I should say something like, drill means a tool used for making holes in hard materials. Give you another example here. Apple means a red fruit. Apple means a red fruit. What's wrong with that? Well, the definition is too broad. The definitions includes plums, and it's too narrow because it excludes green apples and yellow apples. So we want to take note that definitions that are too broad or too narrow fail to convey the essential meaning of the definiendum, the word that we're trying to define. Also, a defective definition can break more than one rule at a time. That's also possible. Well, let's push on to the lexical definition rule number 4. A lexical definition should avoid circularity. A lexical definition should avoid circularity. If I give you this example of the word road rage in parentheses, that's the word that I'm going to define. That's the definiendum. Road rage means rage on the road. Notice I have in the definiends, the word that we're defining, the same two words, road rage. Road rage means rage on the road. The definition is circular because the definiends includes what's in the definiendum. The correct thing to say is road rage means violence directed toward another motorist or passenger or some other person in another vehicle. Anything along those lines would be much better than being circular. Looks like we've got a call or two. Let's see who our first caller is. This is Aaron calling from Redlands. How are you doing today? No, I'm sorry, not Aaron. It's Ian, right?
Hello. Yes, it's Ian.
Ian, okay. It is Ian then. How are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good too. Tell us what your response is, please, Ian.
So my word is NERC.
You might have your speakers on. Can you turn those down, please, or turn them off? Because we're getting feedback. Can't hear you here in the studio. Try it one more time.
My word is NERC.
Snerk? Can you spell it for me?
A cross between a nerd and a dork.
You know, I can barely hear you. Maybe it's the phone reception is not coming in good. Ian, can you text that into us, please? I'd love to hear it, and I'm going to go ahead and give you credit for calling in, but for some reason, your connection is not suitable enough for us to hear in the studio. So please text that into us. Is there a second caller on the line there?
Yes.
Cher from Stockton, how are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing really good, too. Thanks. Thanks for calling in. What's your response to the question of the day?
My response is, a word that's my dad's.
Say the word again.
A job. Half job.
Half job?
Yeah. It's when you start something, but you don't finish, or you do something improperly.
I like that. Half job. Yeah, I could use that on some students, can't I?
Yeah.
Cher, thank you for sharing that and calling in. We appreciate that. You get the point today. Fantastic. Okay. You know, talking about circularity, when I was in East Germany, back in the 80s before the wall fell, I was at the University of Strasbourg and able to go and talk with colleagues on the other side of the Iron Curtain, and noticed all these red banners in the University of Leipzig and just all around the town of Leipzig. We call it Leipzig, Leipzig. And the banner said, Die Lehre von Marx ist allmächtig, weil sie war ist. To translate that out of German, the teachings of Marx are almighty because they are true. And I would have great fun at asking my colleagues at the university to help me understand why the teachings of Marx are almighty. And they would say, because it's true. Well, how do I know that they're true? Well, because they're almighty. How do I know they're almighty? Well, because they're true. And how do I know they're true? Because they're almighty. This is another example of circular reasoning. You can't break out and really define what each of those terms are. They're defined in terms of one another. Circularity, we want to avoid that. The next thing we have is a few sample problems. A few sample problems. Let's go on ahead and put our first example up, which is the word wine, and let's see how it is being defined in this sample problem. Wine means a beverage made from grapes. Wine means a beverage made from grapes. In what way is this definition defective? How many of you would say bad grammar? Maybe it's circular. Maybe it fails to convey the essential meaning. And if you were to choose the last one, you would be absolutely right, because there's no mention being made of it being alcoholic. And also broad, because the definitions can include soft drinks or grape juice, things made from grapes. And every time I see this example, I'm reminded of Welch's carbonated grape soda I've not seen in years. If somebody knows where I can get some of that, either call in or text in. I have to have some of that. I'm reminded of that. The next one is an artist easel. An artist easel, let's define that in our sample, means an easel used by an artist. In which way is this definition defective? Bad grammar? Would you choose circular? Or maybe it's too broad? If you have selected in your mind the second answer, circular, you would be right. It is circular because the term that's being defined is the term that's also doing the defining, artist easel, easel used by an artist. How about carnivore? Let's define carnivore and see how this definition might be defective. Carnivore means a tiger. How many of you would say that this is too narrow, or it's circular, maybe it's too broad? Right, it's too narrow. It doesn't include my sister-in-law, who's a carnivore. Just kidding, a little family humor there. So the definitions excludes lions, wolves, hyenas, and other carnivores. So it is too narrow. It should be broadened to include other animals that are also carnivores. I see we've got another caller coming in, and let's see if we can get them on the line here and see what their response is. This is Marissa calling from Stockton. Marissa, how are you today?
I'm good.
Good.
I was just calling to answer the question of the day.
Please, yes. What is your response?
Well, at my family, we usually call my younger sibling a gnat, A-N-N-A-T, which is an annoying brat, because they're constantly that.
And do you have a chance to use that quite frequently in your household?
Yeah, that's frequent. I got two younger sisters, so it's constantly being said.
Oh, that's pretty good. Marissa, thank you for calling in today. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
And folks, just a reminder, when you call in, please make sure your speakers are down so it doesn't feed back and get confusing with any delay that might be on the patch. Looks like Ian has texted in. Ian, thank you so much for trying to call in and for finally getting the text in. This is great. The word my family used to describe me is nerk. Nerk, N-E-R-K, a cross between a nerd and a dork. Someone fun and or outgoing. I like that. I like that a lot. And the word nerk, that is a great example of a stipulative definition. Ian, you get the participation point for the day. Thank you for that. Well, I think we are on rule number 5 at this point. And I'd like to know how much time. Well, yeah, we probably will take a 5-minute break in another 5 or 10 minutes, but let's push on here with our lexical definitions and rules. This is rule 5. A lexical definition should not be negative when it can be positive. We don't want to phrase a definition of a word negatively when we can phrase it positively. For example, male means not being female. Well, we're defining men at the expense of women and being negative towards women. We don't want to do that. Correction might read as follows. Male means the sex that performs the fertilizing function in generation, or some biological or some other scientific type term. We're not then defining men at the expense of women. As I said, some of these go pretty quick, right? Rule number six. A lexical definition should avoid figurative or obscure or vague, ambiguous language. We'll give examples of figurative, obscure, vague, and ambiguous in just a moment. But here, first, let me give you an example of what we mean by using the word music. Music means the language of the soul. Music means the language of the soul. Does that really tell you what music is? Correction. Music means pleasing vocal or instrumental tones, having structure and continuity. That's a lot better than calling it music of the soul. Maybe our soft jazz, 94.7 The Wave, here in Southern California, might use that definition of the music that they broadcast, but that's a very poor definition if you are going to be writing or talking or debating about it. Figurative means expressing one thing in terms normally denoting another, which may be regarded as analogous, a metaphor or picture painting words that do not expose the essential meaning of a term, like a camel is the ship of the desert. Well, it may have been back in some Bedouin time, times of caravans, when it was essentially a cargo type vehicle, but that definition wouldn't serve us well today, meaning a ship of the desert. It doesn't really tell us much about a camel. When we say that a word is obscure or a definition is obscure, it means that we're hiding the meaning of a word as a result of defective or inappropriate type of language. Maybe from the definitions being needlessly complicated. Vague, as we've talked about before, means expressing a definition with terms that are blurred in meaning, that lack precision or have a continuous range of interpretation, like the word happiness means feeling good versus a relatively stable type of or state of well-being. And then finally, the word ambiguous that we've talked about before means expressing a definition with terms that allow more than one clearly distinct meaning. And we want to avoid those kinds of things. Starting to wrap up on our rules. The rule number seven now, second to the last, a lexical definition should avoid affective terminology. Affective terminology. These are words that play upon the emotion when something is affective. Give you an example. Feminism means a misguided movement that seeks to replace every man with a woman. Well, the correction should be something like this. Feminism seeks to secure for women a status equal to that of men. See, the first one is rather pejorative. It's engendering some unfavorable and derogatory type attitude towards women, when in fact the feminist movement now post-third wave has really arrived in the academy. There's all kinds of feminist standpoints that they're bringing to learning, whether it's feminist law, feminist sociology, feminist viewpoints and a variety of things that have made a significant contribution to learning. Lexical rule number eight. A lexical definition should indicate the context to which the definitions pertains. Example, foul means one, to hit a ball outside the field of play, or two, to infringe the rules. We could correct it by saying, oh, what is the context? Number one, baseball, a foul means in baseball, to hit a ball outside the field of play. Or two, in basketball, to infringe the rules. So, eight rules. Very important that you understand these. The next time that you're doing some defining, as you're writing that paper or preparing that speech, make sure that you go through the 8 rules and that you're not breaking any of those 8 in what you're doing. Why don't we go on ahead and look at another video, and then by then it might be time to make a few comments and then we can take a break. But this video gives some additional interesting facts beyond the criteria and rules for lexical definitions. Facts about some words and their origins. In other words, the etymological root of words. Let's look at some interesting facts. Weird word origins. Take a look at this.
Guys, the word tweet has entered the hallowed text of the Oxford Dictionary, which raises the question, is this the fall of Western civilization? In case you were wondering, no, this is not the fall of Western civilization. This is just the English language being the English language. Language isn't something we think about, especially when it's doing its job. For example, you don't really parse my words as strings of nouns, adjectives, and verbs. Language is for communicating. And because it's so good at what it does, it's alive. Nouns have a tendency to give birth to verbs over time, and individual words can have their own origin stories. Since this is the internet, let's start with something cute. Lemurs! The word lemur actually comes from the Latin lemuris, side note, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, which refer to the specters of the restless dead. Cute and spooky. And speaking of spooky, we've been going boo since the early 19th century. It's probably Scottish in origin, but if you say boo to a Turkish or Spanish speaker, they will also recognize it as an attempt to scare them. It should also be noted that booing at sporting events didn't originate until later. And as much as Europeans might boo Americans for calling their beloved football soccer, the term soccer actually originated in England. The term football had been kicking about for a good long time at that point. In fact, a game called football was banned by a Scottish statute back in the 1400s. During the 1800s, a version of the game called association football emerged, which became a sock or soccer in usage before becoming soccer in the 1860s. As the popularity of soccer spread, it eventually became known as football again throughout England. American football, incidentally, is known as stop-start rugby with padding. Rugby, of course, is played without pads or helmets, which just, ow. Brain injuries are not my favorite. And speaking of brains, human anatomy buffs will recognize the hippocampus as the part of the brain that affects things such as memory, while mythology geeks will immediately think of the hippocampus as Neptune's fishy, dolphin-y seahorse thing. Yeah, it turns out the brain thing came from the horse fish thing. Apparently in 1706, they thought that part of your cerebral cortex looked a bit like a fish. And because English is alive, here's a footnote on words like tweet, which have gained a new meaning from colloquial use. These meanings don't always stick once they lose their cultural context. For example, rutabagas are root vegetables, but apparently they were also slang for dollars in the 1940s, and in the 1920s, a fish could also be a college freshman or a first-time prison inmate. Same thing, right?
Interesting thing with words, right? Well, folks, we've talked a little bit about meaning and the importance of definitions. Why don't we take a brief 5-minute break? When we get back, we'll give you some sample problems, and then we'll swing back into section 2.4 and maybe even have another question of the day for you. So let's go ahead and take our 5-minute break, and I'll see you in 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Graduated from Cal State Dominguez Hills as well.
Ms. Hill. I'm Dr. Hamden, and it gives me great pleasure today to welcome you to our very first STEM in Action event. All right, let the fun begin. There we go.
CSU Dominguez Hills because most of my friends from high school were attending other universities within the area. I wanted to branch off and establish my own network, and that's exactly what I found here at Dominguez Hills, a great network.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're back. During the break, we had a couple of students call in and send us a few messages. The first one was from Bailey saying, I miss Welch's grape soda too. I don't think they make it anymore, but Grape Crush is pretty good too, although not the same experience. Grape Crush. I should have thought about that. Bailey, I'm going to check that out and see how close it is to the original, because I remember distinctly very grape, sweet grape taste. Thank you for that, Bailey. Appreciate that. Someone else called into the booth and said, can I clarify which textbook that we are using? And just to remind, the primary textbook that we're using is the 11th edition of Hurley. Matter of fact, maybe we should go to the overhead cam. If we go to the overhead cam so you can see what the cover looks like, the 11th edition is the one I'm using. But I did say that we can use the 10th edition or the 9th. If you were to find on Amazon or some other bookseller the 10th edition or the 9th edition, you can use those. But what you'll run into is that the pagination, the page numbers are different, and some of the problems are different too. You can still use it. It's not a problem. But to answer the question, 11th edition is what we're using primarily, but it's okay for you to use the 9th or the 10th. And we'll be using the overhead a little bit more later. Okay, we've got a few sample problems we want to get into. And try your hand at some of these. If we were to define poverty as follows, what would be its defect? Poverty means not having enough money. In which way is that defective? Is it needlessly negative? You do see the word not there. Is it vague? Is it ambiguous? Well, it's not negative towards anybody, so maybe that's not the problem. But if you were to say vague, you'd be right. How much is not enough? Poverty. How much is not enough having money. Try your hand at this next one. Happy means not being sad. In which way is this definition defective? Is it effective, obscure, needlessly negative? Yeah, I'd go with needlessly negative. You know, happiness is positive, so there's no need for the definitions to be negative. Try your hand at this next one. Candle is defined as, candle means a solid piece of petroleum distillate on axial fiber. Yeah, now imagine, guys, you're going to the Hallmark store somewhere where they sell candles. You want to get your girlfriend a candle for Valentine's Day, and you ask the clerk, can you tell me where the solid pieces of petroleum distillate on axial fiber are? Well, what's the problem there? In which way is it defective? Yeah, it's obscure, right? It needlessly is hiding, and it's overly complicated, the definitions, the words that are doing the defining. Take a look at our last sample problem here. Stroke means one, single motion of a brush, two, a scoring unit. In which way is this definition defective? Might you choose vague or obscure or fails to indicate the context? Right, if you were to say the last one, the first one refers to painting. So you would say stroke means in painting, a single motion of a brush, and two, relating to gold, a scoring unit, and thirdly, to swimming, so on and so forth. You see how that works? Well, folks, as we have finished now section 2.5, as we said in the announcements on Blackboard, there are some problems that you should try your hand at to make sure that you're getting these concepts. And so take a look at pages 115 to 116. Section 2.5 at the end there, there's Roman numeral 1, where there's some homework problems. Try your hand at 2 through 16 even. Let's go to another video that talks about etymology, the origin of words. The ancient words are embedded in much of our modern language, and how many actually originated in other languages and were adopted by the English language are quite a few, probably more than we realize. So this video gives us a few humorous examples of where some very common words actually came from, what their etymological root is. Take a look at this video.
Okay.
Ketchup. Wait up.
ABC.
Checkmate.
Shabbat.
All right.
Robot.
Hold.
Robota.
Barbecue.
What?
Barbacoa.
¿Qué pasó?
Yes. Shampoo.
Shampoo.
Why don't we take a moment and give a few other examples here? Can we go to the overhead cam? There is a word in ancient Greek, and a lot of our words come from Greek. And let's see if we can zoom in on that. The word arche. And that's an A-R-C-H-E, you know, meaning anarchy, archangel, archetype. This is the word rule, meaning rule from ancient Greek. And how about the word biblion? Bib-li-iota, omicron nu, B-I-B-L-I-O-N, is the Greek word for book. We see that in bibliography, or the word Bible. There's another interesting word. With a sigma, I'm sorry, a terminal sigma, for dynamic, dunamis, for dynamism, for dynamite. This is the word for power. Last one. Have you ever heard of Xerox or the xerographic process? You've probably heard of a Xerox, a manufacturer of some of the early photocopiers. They probably had somebody who knew ancient Greek. And that's a rho, omicron cross sigma, and G, rho, alpha, graphe. Xerox, or xerographic, somebody at Xerox, or maybe their marketing company, knew that xeros and graphe in the ancient Greek means dry writing. A photocopier does dry writing. Isn't that amazing? Folks, there's a number of words in our language that we commonly use that if we just did a little bit of digging, we would find out their etymological root, where they came from in some other ancient language and was absorbed or brought into our language. Folks, I said after 2.5, we want to circle back to 2.4 and then finish up this chapter. And let's see if we can actually do that. Just to look ahead a little bit too, I had mentioned at the beginning of our broadcast today that if we had time, I would start familiarizing you with the first critical reasoning project, the first of the three. And we may have a little bit of time at the end where we would go through some of that. So just to alert everybody, if we have time, we are going to get into that. But let's see how we do with section 2.4 and wrapping up chapter 2. Chapter 2.4 has to do with criteria for lexical definitions. The criteria for lexical definitions. Let's see. We have got to go up to... you know, folks, I guess before I do that, I want to talk about the next question of the day. The next question of the day. And folks in the booth, I apologize. I just lost my space, my place here for a minute. Let's see. Question of the day. What are the reasons that you should or should not use the language of your community? Young scholars, that would be maybe your friends, your acquaintances, people that you know, and that you should or should not use those around your family or around your employer. Call in with your responses. So the second question of the day, and folks in the booth, I'm on page 3 of session 4's script. What are the reasons you should or should not use the language of your community around your family or around your employer? You can call in with your responses, and we'll take the first 5 of the typewritten responses. So we are on definitional techniques. Definitional techniques. Thank you for putting up the question at the bottom third there on our screen. And to talk about definitional techniques, we're relying on some of the material that we learned in section 2.2, having to do with intentional and extensional, section 2.2. Matter of fact, we have a graphic that we can put up that talks about the cognitive meaning of a term, and the example that's given on this slide 101 from lecture 2 is for the word student. For the word student, that's actually the decision-making table we're on page 4 of session 4's script. The cognitive meaning of the term for student, there is a on the left-hand side, excellent, this is the one. There are class members. This is for the word inventor, though, it looks like. And then on the right-hand side, there are the intentional. So yes, let's take a look at the word inventor. The word inventor denotes people like Thomas Alva Edison, Alexander Graham Bell, Morse, the Wright brothers. That is to give an extensional definition of the word inventor. We're defining the term by its members of the class that give us an example of the word inventor. Another way to give a cognitive meaning of a term to define it is to tell what it connotes. That is to give an intentional definition by listing its attributes. We would say an inventor connotes people who are clever, intuitive, creative, imaginative, All of those are attributes of an inventor. So, folks, we're using this kind of method to go about giving definition to words. We're using these as techniques, either to define things by class or to define them by attribute. And this is another powerful way to give definition to things, to employ these kinds of techniques. So an extensional or denotative type definition, an extensional definition is one that assigns a meaning to a term by indicating the members of the class that the definitum denotes. There are several ways that we can go about doing this. These are the first three that the book mentions. One is to point to them, which is the demonstrative definition, and we'll get to that in a minute, or to name them individually, which is an enumerative type definition, or thirdly, to name them by group, which is a definition by subclass. So we'll take a look at those three in just a moment. First, I want to go to some of the responses that we've got coming in for the second question of the day. Answer to the question today was just kidding, as in just kidding by a good example. Let's see. Maybe so. I don't know if I fully understand your question, Michelle. Would kidding, as in just kidding, be a good example? Oh, and maybe you're referring to the first question. If you're referring to the first question in terms of a made-up word, that's in the dictionary, so this wouldn't apply. Maybe you're talking about the second one, and maybe you would use that around your parents. I don't know. It depends. Maybe it depends on your parents. Hale, thank you for yours. Also, the reason why you should not use the language of your community is employers may not understand the phrases and may give a non-professional environment to others or consider you as being non-professional. Hale, that's very good reasoning. Yes, I like that. Thank you for that. Very good. Well, folks, let's go on ahead and talk about these first three types of definitions. The first is a demonstrative definition. If we were standing at the beach, which is about 15, 20 minutes away from here, and we're looking at the beautiful Palos Verdes Peninsula, and we're taking maybe some foreign students that had never seen anything like that before, and they were to ask, as they heard the word peninsula, and they were saying, what is Palos Verdes Peninsula? I could say that the Palos Verdes Peninsula is a geological mass of land that juts into the ocean like a finger into the ocean. But a much quicker way to do it, if we're there standing at Rat Beach, is to simply point at it and say, that is a peninsula. That is the Palos Verdes Peninsula. And this is a complete demonstrative definition because there is only one Palos Verdes Peninsula. It indicates the only member of the class is denoted by the definiendum, the thing that's being defined. The same thing with the word book. If somebody says, what is a book? We could say, well, it's got a cover in the back, it has a spine that has a title on it, in the back there's an index, a glossary, and in the front is all the publication material and a table of contents. Well, that's a way to define it, but a demonstrative definition is to simply say, here's a book, and the person would understand that this is an example of what all the books in the world look pretty much like. Demonstrative definition is one of the most probably one of the oldest methods of defining things. Imagine in caveman days when they didn't have a developed language and there's up on a ridge an animal that they wanted to go hunt. You can imagine the caveman say, right? Saying, that's what we're gonna go eat. And he's defining it by pointing at it. How many of you have a younger sibling who sometimes can't sleep at night and maybe wakes you up and takes you into the kitchen and there she is, little two-year-old, and she points up at the cabinet going, that means get me the cereal down, I'm hungry, and she points to the refrigerator and get me some milk, right? Because she doesn't have a developed language yet. Demonstrative definition, very powerful means of defining what we want or what we're talking about, demonstrative definition. Well, let's move on to an enumerative definition. Actors and actresses mean people like, and then we would list the members of that class. And would we say that this is a partial enumerative definition of the word actress, or is it a complete enumerative? Well, it'd have to be partial because we don't have a picture of all the actresses in the world. And it doesn't include people like RuPaul and Uncle Milty, who are also considered actresses. Looks like we've got a call coming in, and that's RuPaul. And let's see if we can, this is Connor calling from Stockton. Connor, thanks for calling in. How are you doing today?
Good. How about you?
Really good. Thanks. What's your response?
For the second question of the day, I think you should not use the same language you use in your community with your employer because it could be slang and seen as unprofessional.
Good. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Connor, thank you for calling in. You get your participation point. We appreciate you contacting us. Let's see. Let me give you a mental thought question. Think about this in the confines of your mind. Can you give a complete enumerative definition of what is meant by Pacific Coast states? So we're the United States, continental United States. Can you give me a complete enumerative list of Pacific Coast states? The answer would be, right, California, Oregon, Washington. Those are the Pacific Coast states. Well, let's move on to a definition by subclass. Definition by subclass. This kind of definition indicates the members of the class by naming the subclasses. For example, tool means a wrench or a screwdriver, and so on. Is this a partial list by subclass, or is it a complete list by subclass? If you said partial, you would be right, because we're not listing every tool. Notice also that we're listing by subclass. Each of these tools have a subclass unto themselves of tools. For example, when we said a wrench, there are different types of wrenches, right? A monkey wrench, a crescent wrench, a spanner. Screwdriver, there's a standard, there's a Phillips screwdriver. A drill, different types of drill, a wood bit, a diamond bit for much harder substances. Would you say that that's a complete? No, we already said that this is, I think we said on this one, that this is a partial definition by subclass because we're not listing all of the tools. Another example, atomic component means an electron, proton, and a neutron. Is this an example of a complete definition by subclass or not? Yeah, if there are leptons and other subatomic elements that you're aware of, then we would say that this is an impartial or an incomplete, a partial list by definition by subclass. Looks like we've got another call, and somebody just texted in, and our caller is Michelle calling from Corona. Michelle, how are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good, too. Thanks. Please, what's your response?
So I did respond to the first question of the day.
Okay.
By email, and then this is my second response to the second question.
Okay, good.
So I think that we shouldn't use the language in our community around our family because some of the language might be disrespectful, and I wouldn't want to be disrespectful to my family.
Uh-huh. Good. Good.
Yeah.
Very good. Appreciate that response, Michelle, and thank you for typing in for the first question, too. You get the point. Very good. It looks like Jose has sent in a text. Jose, thank you for that. It reads, you should not use the language of your community around your family because it can be a little too explicit and uncomfortable for your family to hear. You might not know how they would react to what you say. Ah, very good, Jose, very smart, yeah. Good thinking, all of you. Let's go on ahead and do a sample problem or two using the information that we just learned about definitions. And this first one is to define the word city. City means Los Angeles, Paris, London, New York, and so on. What kind of an extensional definition is this? How many of you would say demonstrative? No, he didn't make that sound, right? Enumerative or definition by subclass. If you said enumerative, you would be right. And it's partial because only a few cities are mentioned. Try this next one. The moon means that as you point to it. And now I'm not going to make that noise just because you're expecting it. The moon means that as you point to it. What kind of an extensional definition is it? And if you said demonstrative, you would be right. Even though I didn't make the noise, you would still know that that's it because there's only one of its kind also. And that's a complete demonstrative definition because it's the only orbiting satellite that we have of its kind. And let's see, conifer is the last sample problem for the moment. Means a fir, pine, cedar, and so on. What kind of an extensional definition is this? Is it demonstrative, enumerative, or definition by subclass? That's right. If you said definition by subclass, you would get the point. And this is not a complete list either. We're only listing a few of the subclasses. Well, we've talked about extensional or denotative, defining things in terms of classes, members of the class. Now we want to go over to connotative definitions or intentional definitions that define things by their attributes. Another powerful way of defining things. This assigns a meaning to a word by identifying the qualities or the attributes that the word connotes. Remember, extensional definition defines things by indicating the members of the class that the definium, the word that's being defined, what it denotes. So the first is a synonymous definition. The definiens is a single word that connotes the same attributes as the definiendum. A synonymous definition, our fourth example. Tranquility means peacefulness. Well, the definiendum, tranquility, means the same thing as the definiens. It's a synonym. They're synonymous. Peacefulness. That's to use the technique of a synonymous definition. Etymological definition. We've talked about this. You've got this covered, right? It assigns a meaning to a word by disclosing the word's ancestry in either its own language or in other languages. This is the fifth one, the etymological type definition. Oikos means house. Nemos means to arrange. Oikos and nemos, put them together, that's oikonomia. Sounds a lot like economy. To arrange one's house, to be a good steward of one's house. A home economist. The sixth type of definitional technique is the operational definition, right out of the book. This assigns a meaning to a word by specifying a procedure that determines whether or not the word applies. For example, a substance is considered to be radioactive if and only if a Geiger counter registers a reading when the sensor is brought near to it. Key words you want to listen for is if and only if. Our textbook uses that primarily as the indicator words for an operational type definition. Seventh definitional technique is a definition by genus and difference. Genus and difference. This was invented by Aristotle back in the 4th century BC. This definitional technique is more applicable and achieves more adequate results than any other kind of intentional definition. There's a chart on page 108 in our textbook that identifies all the various techniques. Maybe we could go to our overhead cam and take a look at that. All of the various techniques and the types of definitions. And you see the types of definitions listed across the top here, from stipulative to persuasive, and the techniques from demonstrative down to genus and difference, and each of these techniques can or cannot produce these types of definitions. Look at Aristotle's genus and difference. It can produce all of the five types of definition from stipulative to persuasive. This indicates to us that it is one of the more powerful definitional tools. You also see how I've divided the first top half as the extensional types or denotative definitions. The bottom half are the intentional or the connotative type definitions. But let's see how this genus and difference works. If we were given an example of doe. And doe means a female deer. We need to come up with a difference word. And the difference word in this case is female, the word female. The difference is the attribute that distinguishes the various species within a genus, says Aristotle. In logic, the species is simply the smaller class that results when the genus, the larger class, is limited by the difference words. And I think we've got a sample slide for you that would show this using ice and water. And let's see if that comes up. The slide number 131. Ice means frozen water. So ice is the species term. Water is the genus term. And you see how we've arranged one inside the other, right? Here's the species term. Here's water, the genus term. And the difference between the two is the fact that they're frozen. So in logic, the species is simply the larger class results when the genus is limited by the difference words. So first you want to select a term that's more general than the term to be defined. That's more general than the term to be defined. Then you narrow it down so that it means the same thing as the term that's being defined. Notice what the difference term is in each of these. Fawn means a very young deer. Fawn is the species, genus is deer. The difference is very young. Skyscraper means a very tall building. So you've got building, which is in the genus. The species is skyscraper, just one of the classes, one of the types of buildings. A very tall is the difference term. Daughter means a female offspring. Female is the difference term. Husband means a married man. There's several examples in the book that I would encourage you to take a look at to make sure that you understand how that works. And there is on our quiz and on our midterm one or two examples that you want to be able to identify so that you get that point. Let's do a few sample problems here. And we are now on the sample problem for the word proceed that we're going to define. Proceed is derived from the Latin verb procedere, to go ahead. What kind of intentional definition is this? See if you can answer that. Synonymous, etymological, definition by genus and difference. If you chose etymological, you would get the point. This definition gives the Latin ancestry of the definiendum, the word that we're trying to define. Indolence means lazy. Our next sample problem. Indolence means lazy. What kind of an intentional definition is this? And yes, if you chose the first one, synonymous, that indolence is synonymous with laziness, then that is the kind of intentional definition, a synonymous definition. Definiens is laziness, same thing as the definiens, the definiendum, indolence. Take a look at this next one. Boar means a male pig. Boar means a male pig. How many of you would go with synonymous? Anybody for etymological definition? How about a definition by genus and difference? And if you chose the last one, you would get the point. Pig names the genus and male specifies the difference. Male is the difference term in that one. A joke is funny if and only if people laugh when it is told. What kind of an intentional definition is this? How many of you would go with operational? And if you did, recognizing the if and only if, you'd get the point. The operation is telling the joke and determining whether the audience laughs or not. How about vegetable means things like a tomato, turnip, potato, and so on. What kind of definition is this? Definition by subclass. That's right. If you chose the first one, you'd be correct. Each one of those is a subclass and has even further subclasses of their same type. The definiens name the subclasses of vegetables. And a potato is cooked on our next sample problem. If and only if it is soft when removed from the oven, what kind of definition is this? Demonstrative? No, he didn't make that noise. Etymological? No, he didn't throw any ancient Greek up. Operational, that's right. if and only if our key indicator term for an operational definition. The operation consists of removing the potato from the oven and determining its softness. And I think we've got one last one. Philosophy is derived from the Greek word philos and sophia. What kind of a definition is this? That's right, it's the second one, the etymological definition. The definition gives the Greek ancestry of the definiendum, the word that we're doing the defining of. So I think that that gives you enough sample problems to look at, but I would like you to take a look at the end of section 2.4 after you read it, if you have not read it. The homework problems reside in two Roman numerals. The first Roman numeral 1, do problems 2 through 10, the even ones, and after that, Roman numeral section 2, and do problems 2 through 8 even. And then as we have an opportunity, we will hopefully next week be able to maybe jump into a few sample problems for you. Also, because this is the end of chapter 2, we need to get the a quiz for chapter 2 up and running. We will do that next week. It'll be up for about a week or so, week and a half maybe. And folks, you need to reread chapter 2, make sure you're comfortable with it, do some sample problems to make sure you've got the concepts down. Hopefully you have printed out the chapter notes from Blackboard, the PowerPoint, so that when you sit down and do quiz number 2, it will not give you any kind of a challenge. So I want to wish everybody a great middle of the week. We will see you next Wednesday at the same time. Everybody enjoy what's left of it and stay cool. Take care, everybody.